Hi, morning church. Once again, we are gathering together in the name of the Lord and pray that you have been keeping yourself safe and well. And I believe that, you know, whenever we are gathered together in His name, the scripture says, when we gather in His name, He shall be there in the midst of us. You know, wherever you are in your homes, you know, I really pray that we will learn to invite the presence of God, you know, into our life, into our family, and allow God to do a new work in each and every one of us. Last week, I started a series, what we call The Blessing, in conjunction with the release of the song, The Blessing, over Malaysia as well. And you know, I believe with all my heart that God wants to make us a blessing. You know, we are not just called to survive and try to make sure this, you know, this difficult time, or try to survive this difficult period. But God has called us to be a channel of His grace, His mercy, a channel of His blessing, not only to our family members, but also to our nation. And last week, I started a series of sermon, and I talked about Adam, the first man that was blessed by God. And God's plan for Adam and Eve is that they will be fruitful, multiply, they will dominate, they will be a blessing to all the creation that God had created. But Adam, because of his rebellion, instead of listening, following, and heeding the voice of God, he listened to other voices. And because of that, man fell from God's grace and mercy, from the blessing that God had intended them to be, and curse came upon the whole of all creation because of man's disobedience. And this morning I want to talk about the blessing that God intended for us. As Adam lose the blessing, we find a man in his obedience. Not only he received the blessing of God, but he became what I call the carrier of God's blessing, you know, to the nation through one man's obedience. Today we are going to look at the life of Abraham. You have the scripture, turn with me to the book of Genesis, chapter 12, verse 1 to verse 3. Now I know that, you know, for the last few years, people are very lazy in turning to scripture. You know, either we check our handphone or we hope that the pastor will put it on the face, on the PowerPoint so that we can read. But I really want to encourage you to turn to the scripture, you know, and because you can read more than what was being placed in the slide. In Genesis chapter 12, verse 1 to verse 3, it says, "And now the Lord said to Abraham, get out of your country, from your family, and from your father's house, to a land that I will show you, and I will make you a great nation." In verse 2, "I will make you a great nation. I will bless you and make your name great, and you shall be a blessing. I will bless those," the scripture said, "that bless you, and I will curse him who curse you. And in you, all the families of the earth shall be blessed." In you, all the family of the earth shall be blessed. Adam and Eve was blessed by God. In their disobedience, chaos came into the hold of creation. God always wanted to restore such blessing to mankind. He always wanted to use His people, His children, as the vessel of blessing. And God found that man in Abraham. The blessing was attached to Abraham's act of obedience. Now, in this portion of scripture, most people will quote verse 2 and verse 3. You know, God will bless, I will make you a great nation, I will bless you. But verse 1 is important because it showed us how Abraham responded to God. And because of his response, God made him the vessel of blessing. There are a few things we can learn from this portion of scripture this morning. Few principles that I think will help us as we learn to follow, as we learn to live our Christian life, as we learn to use this life that God has given us as a channel of His blessing to the
people around him. The first thing that we can learn from Abraham, the life of Abraham, is this. He hear the voice of God. Hear his voice. The scripture say, and the Lord say to Abraham. Abraham's obedience was prompted. Was a prompting. We do not know for how long did Abraham hear the voice of God. But as Abraham hear the voice of God, he responded to the voice, to the calling of God upon his life. And how God spoke, we do not know. How God speak to Abraham, we do not know. We do not know about his background enough. You know, but he hear this voice. He hear this prompting, this command. And he obey. When God speak to us, sometimes it's difficult to explain how. You know, we hear often people, oh, the Lord speak to me. And sometimes we have this question mark, you know, when people say, oh, the Lord speak to me. And especially in this time we are living in with these new challenges, we have all kind of people making prophetic prediction. And I pray that whatever they say, they really hear from God. I really pray that, you know, it's not just assumption or using God's name in vain. I really pray that we hear from God. But Abraham here, we do not know how God speak to him, but as he heard the voice of God, he obeyed the voice of God. That prompting that God started in the life of Abraham. I remember the time when the Lord speak to me. Some people ask, Pastor, how did the Lord speak to me? It started with a simple prompting, and the thing began to grow. From a simple prompting, it began to grow, and after a while, you get consumed by that thought, you know. And the Lord speak to me was when I was pretty young. I was in Bible school during my second year in Bible school, and I felt this prompting. The Lord was speaking to me, and it was not an easy prompting because the Lord was speaking to me about moving out from the church that I got saved to the church, from a church that very much part of the family that I grew up with, the church that had been very supportive for me. You know, all my friends were there. And the Lord said, Peter, I want you to move out. No, not because there's nothing wrong with the church. It's a tremendous church. But I felt that prompting. And it was uneasy. For a long time, I just kept that in my heart and I didn't want to do anything about it. But until the day I felt that, you know, the prompting began to grow and it began to kind of affect me, even my prayer life, if I do not listen to this prompting. So I went and speak to the pastor about it, and I remember the pastor asked me, where are you going if you're leaving this church? I said, I have no idea. I have no idea. But it started with a prompting. And I realized one thing, is that when God began to promise, when God began to place something in our hearts, in our life, we have to respond to the very voice of God. When we respond to His voice, God can make us a blessing. God can make us a blessing. Turn with me to the book of Acts chapter 8, verse 26. Now, the angel of the Lord spoke to Philip, saying, arise and go towards Jerusalem, towards the south along the road, which goes down, from Jerusalem to Gaza. This is a desert. Verse 27. So he arose and went, and behold, a man of Ethiopia, a eunuch of great authority under Candace, the queen of the Ethiopian, who had charge of all her treasury, and have come to Jerusalem to worship. Verse 28. And was returning, and sitting in his chariot, he was reading Isaiah the prophet. Then the Spirit said to Philip, go near and overtake this chariot. So Philip ran to him and heard him reading the prophet Isaiah and said, do you understand what you are reading? Now in this scripture, Philip hear the voice, the prompting of God. He hear the voice and prompting of God. But there are so many things in this scripture that Philip could have objected. First thing is this. Why? What is there? What is there in the desert? God prompted him to go towards the road, the path that is towards the desert. What is there in the desert? The second objection that Philip maybe could have was that it's an Ethiopian, that he's speaking to a Gentile. I'm not so sure about the third objection about the eunuch part. And then the next thing is that the Lord say, Philip, I want you to overtake the chariot. Overtake the chariot. The last person to do that was Elijah, who ran faster than the chariot. So you find that what the Lord prompted Philip to do, what the Lord was saying to Philip was out of the norm. It's not the ordinary. It's to an unusual place, speaking to an unusual people. You know, things that he's not familiar with, to do the unusual thing. It seems to be ridiculous to in many points. But Philip's obedience to the voice of God, to the prompting of God, result in a blessing not only to the Ethiopian eunuch, but to the entire nation of Ethiopia. The eunuch returned to his land, spread the news. Many Ethiopians come to believe, and for 1,800 years, the Christian church flourished in Ethiopia without a missionary. It flourished without missionary work. And, you know, it was in the 18th century that the Europeans began to discover Ethiopia. And to their surprise, there is a thriving Ethiopian church that have existed in the land. Because of one man who heard from God and walked along the desert road. Walk in the obedience. Obedience can be such a blessing. And the Lord spoke to Abraham. And Abraham had to begin, you know, not only hear the words of God, but to begin to walk in obedience. And the question this morning, has God been speaking to you? Have God been speaking to you? And what do you do with that voice that the Lord has spoken? Maybe some of us have received word of prompting from the Lord. Maybe some of us in our time of prayer, we hear God speaking to us about particular areas and particular things. Maybe for some of us, we have received prophetic words over our life. The question is that, have we responded to the voice of God? Or for many of us, we hear the voice of God, but what we do is that we just place it aside. Obedience will result in blessing. It's not how many prophetic words you receive that is going to determine the blessing, but it's in the act of your obedience. If God will only have spoken only one thing over your life and you have stepped out in obedience and that is good enough, better than the many hundreds or thousands of words that have been spoken over you. Act of obedience. Abraham hear the voice of God and he obeyed. And he obeyed. And God make him a blessing. The second thing I want to talk about is that we have to not only step out, but we also have to step in. The scripture say, you know, the Lord spoke to him and said, get out to a land that I will show you. Abraham took a big step of faith to step into what I call the divine blessing. Now, many people, they step out, but never step in. They step out, but never step in. What do I mean by that? Now, when God first called me into the ministry, it was a step out from my comfort zone to what I'm familiar with. But I can step out. But the next thing I need to do is that I need to begin to step into the very thing that God has called me. Some people, they step out and they remain there and they begin what I call wandering in the wilderness. In Hebrews chapter 3, verse 16, here referring to the children of Israel, who was called by God. When God first called them to come out of the land of Egypt, many of them hesitated. And at some point, they even complained to Moses, why have you brought us out of this place, you know, into this wilderness? But in verse 16, for who having heard, they rebelled. Indeed, it was not all who came out of Egypt led by Moses. Now, with whom was he angry? With who was God angry for 40 years? Was it not those whose corpse fell in the wilderness? Verse 18. And to whom did he swear that they would not enter his rest, but those who did not obey? Those who did not obey shall not enter into his rest. So we see they could not enter in because of their unbelief. Children of Israel step out of Egypt, but refuse to step into the promised land. They choose to hear the voice of the 10 spies who say there's giant in the land. They refuse to listen to Joshua and Caleb and say, you know what, we can do it. Let's step in, let's conquer this place as the Lord promised, because it's a land filled with milk and honey. They step out of Egypt, but they never step into the promised land. And that's how I find many Christians. They step out their old life. They come to believe in Jesus, but they never step into the very Christian life itself, the promises of God, the provision of God, the touch of God in their life. And they just keep on wandering in their Christian life. Maybe for many of them, their Christianity is very much like just going to church on Sunday morning. That's all. But God wants to do a much more deeper work in our life. And we must step into His promises. We must step into His word. We must get in it. Don't wander in the desert for 40 years like the children of Israel. Unfulfilled destiny derived from incomplete obedience. Some of us, God have great plan for our life. Some of us, God want to do great work through our life. Some of us, God want to use us to be a blessing. Some of us have God's calling placed upon our life. Some of us can impact people like no other people can. But because of incomplete obedience, we step out, but we never step into what God has called us to do. We live in wilderness. We constantly struggle with wants. We constantly struggle instead of living in the land that God has destined us to live. So not only stepping out, we have to step in. The third thing I want to touch on is that we have to make the sacrifice. God, as God speaks to Abraham, God's word is that get out of your country, your family, to a land that I will show you. Abraham's faith involved big sacrifices. Separation from that that is secure, separation from that which is comfortable, to go into something that is uncertain, unknown. You know, I mean, with a family, he have everything that he need. And many believe that Abraham come from even a well-to-do family. But now God say, you know what, move out to the place, to the land that you have. God did not specify which land, but say you just move out in obedience. And he had to make that sacrifices. We want convenient Christianity, where everything fit into our lifestyle. We want a Christianity that fit into our schedule. We want a Christianity that fit into our preference. And I find that in today's church, this has become a norm. Many people want to choose what time the service fit us. Oh, I like a morning service. I like a later past service. We want the service to fit into us. Now, not because you got anything else to do. It's just that some people just that. We want a Christianity that basically fit into our lifestyle. I don't have to change the way I am. I can continue with living my life outside, come to God, and God will just love me as I am. We want the kind of Christianity. But the Bible never offered that. But rather, the Bible tells us if you want to follow Jesus, there will be trials, there will be persecution, that will be the norm of the life that we want to live as a Christian. And that is what the early church go through, trial, persecution. But in spite of the trial and persecution, the church make the impact. The church made the impact. But today what we want is that we want to be entertained. We don't want the commitment. in Luke chapter 9, verse 23, then Jesus said to them all, if anyone desire to come after me, let him take up the cross. Deny himself. Let him deny himself, take up his cross once a while. Take up his cross during the Easter Sunday. Take up his cross whenever he is convenient. But the scripture said, take up his cross what? Daily. And follow me. Take up his cross daily and follow me. For whoever desires to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake will save it. Deny himself. Take up the cross. Loses his life for my sake. And for many, this is not the Christianity that we want. Because this does not fit into our lifestyle. It doesn't fit into the way we live our life. There's a cost. Abraham paid the price for the blessing of God. And today we want the blessing of God. The church wants the blessing of God. We want the blessing of God. But the question is still the same as I've mentioned last week. Where is the sacrifice? And much of what have been taught today in many churches is the benefit of the cross, but we are silenced on the demand of the cross. We talk about the benefit of the cross, but we are silent on the demand of the cross. Abraham hear the voice of God. He step out in faith. He step into God's very plan and purpose. And there were price that he had to pay. There were sacrifices that he had to make. And because of that, God used him in such a mighty way. The last thing I want to talk about is that we need to be the vessel. The scripture say, the Lord speak to Abraham and say, you shall be a blessing. Now, a new word I have learned during this recent COVID-19. A new word. If I can pronounce this properly. Asymptomatic carrier. Asymptomatic carrier. A person that has become infected with a pathogen, a virus, a disease, but display no sign or symptom. Although unaffected, the carrier can transmit to others. The carrier plays a critical role in transmission of common infections such like typhoid, influenza, cholera, COVID-19, even HIV. He's a carrier, but he was not affected. And during this COVID-19, there are many people who were dead. They were asymptomatic carrier. If there's anything we are called to transmit in our life, it's not COVID-19. We are called to transmit the blessing of God through our obedience. In 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 20, say, in a great house there are not only vessels of gold and silver, but also of wood and clay, some for honor and some for dishonor. Therefore, if anyone cleanses himself from the latter, he will be a vessel of honor, sanctified and useful for the master, prepared for every good work. The scripture here describes about the different vessel that is in the house. There were some of gold, of value, some silver, some of wood, some of clay, maybe of lesser value. But I say, when the scripture says talk about vessel of honor, he's not talking about the material in which this vessel was made of. When the scripture say vessel of honor, is talk about if anyone cleanses himself from the latter, if anyone cleanses himself, he will be a vessel of honor. So it's not what you are made up of that's going to determine whether you are the vessel of honor or dishonor, but if you are to cleanse yourself, your background, your upbringing, your surroundings should never be the excuse of the way your life has been lived out. is what you do. It's when you cleanse yourself, then you become useful. You are prepared for every good work. You know, many people blame their past. They blame their background. They blame their parents. They blame their teacher. We were having this fun in a cell group, and someone was trying to use Bahasa Malaysia, and it didn't work out that well. And so we were just teasing this person on the on her Bahasa Malaysia. And she said, it's teacher's fault. You know, it was teacher's fault. The teacher didn't do a good job when she was in school. So it was in good fun, and we just have a good laugh over it. How many of us, we were constantly living our life blaming people around us for the way our life is living now? The Bible says, if we were to cleanse, if we were to do something over your surrounding, if you were only do something over the situation that you are, if you only do something about where your life is heading, if you only make changes, if you only pursue the plan, the purpose of God in our life, then you will achieve all that God wants you to achieve. You will be the blessing that God intends you to be. If only we cleanse ourselves, as the scripture says. You have been blessed, and you are called to be a blessing. Abraham heard the voice of God. God speak to him. God said, Abraham, leave behind all that is dear to you. Leave behind all that you are comfortable with. That was what God's challenging him to do. And God is calling him to step out from that which is familiar, to step into that which is unknown. The sacrifice is going to be painful. The sacrifice is going to be painful. Leaving behind all to pursue the prompting of God, to pursue that which he is unfamiliar, which he is not even sure of, but God has spoken over his life. Abraham stepped out from his comfort zone, stepped into the purpose of God. He made the sacrifices. And because of his obedience, God said, you know what, Abraham? I'm going to make you a blessing. I will bless you and make your name great. I will bless you and make your name great. And you shall be a blessing. And through you, Abraham, all the families of the earth shall be blessed. Adam, he lose that blessing because of disobedience. Instead of listening to the voice of God, he listened to a different kind of voice in his life. But Abraham hear the voice of God, and he began to step in obedience. What is God saying to you today? What have the Lord been prompting your heart for the last few years? What has been the tugging of God in your life that you know this is what the Lord wants you to do, but you're still holding back? You're still keeping the distance. And because of that, many of us fail to enter into the destiny that God intends us to live in. God trusted Abraham with his blessing because of a life of obedience. Not only for a moment, but continuous obedience. Even to the point when God said, you know what? Offer your son Isaac as a sacrifice. He obeyed. He obeyed. His obedience was complete. And the question is that, can God trust me with his blessing? Can God trust you with his blessing? Let's look to the Lord in prayer. thank you, Lord. As we get a song ready to sing unto the Lord, let's just think about what has been shared this morning. God wants us to be the carrier of His blessing, even to our nation, as a church, as God's people. Not only pronouncing a blessing, we are called to be the salt of the earth, to impact, to influence, to make changes. And we can only do that when we walk in obedience to Him. We will have our struggle. Obedience is an areas of continuous struggle in our life. But every time we obey the voice of God, life can be changed, transformed. Every time we obey the voice of God, people are blessed. Our obedience is the key to blessing in the life of those around us and even to our nation. God wants to bless us so that we can be the blessing. Hallelujah. Let's sing this song together. We praise you, Lord.
All I am and have, and
yes, all for you, Lord. We praise you. All I am and have and never hope to be, for this only, for this only, your will that I am free, for this only, your will that I am. Sing again, for this only, for this only. Your divine plan and destiny, oh God, is when we walk, oh God, to the voice, to the prompting of your Holy Spirit. It is in the life of obedience, oh God.
I am.
Sing again, for His own name, His own name. Your will that I.
Some of us are constantly struggling with frustration in our Christian life. We have the best of intention. We want to please God. And we all declare, Lord, we love you. But yet we find our Christian life are constantly like a boat that is in a storm, being tossed to and fro. And whenever we found that as though we have made some progress, and then we find ourselves being pulled back once again. And we're wondering, why are we going through this over and over again in our walk, in our relationship with God? I've been there. I know what it means and how it feels to be living that kind of Christian life. And if we were to be completely honest and take a deeper look into our heart, most of our constant struggle in our Christian life is because of area of disobedience. Incomplete obedience derail us from the life that God wants us to live. God wants to make you a blessing to those that is around you. You can only be a blessing when you walk in obedience to His prompting, as you listen to His voice,
you step into that which God has called you to be, that which He has called you to do. There will be sacrifices, there will be pain in the offering. But as you begin to step, you become the vessel, the carrier of God's blessing to those that is around. I want you to place your hand on your heart this morning, wherever you are, and pray this prayer of dedication unto the Lord. Lord Jesus, we come before you. And Lord, we are sorry, Lord God, that we have ignored your voice and we have choose, Lord God, to live our own life, oh God. But Lord, this morning, Lord, we come before you and we dedicate our life anew, Lord God. And we pray, Lord, you will use this vessel. You will use our life to be a channel of blessing, Lord, to those around us. We want your blessing, oh God, so that we can bless those around, so that we can impact, influence. Lord, we commit our life to you. Use us, Lord, we pray. Even this time where so many people are struggling, Lord, where so many people are facing uncertainty, use us, oh God, to be encouragement, to bring hope. Use us, Lord, so that we can be a blessing to our nation. We pray all this in Jesus' name. God bless you. Just want to encourage you this week that make this your prayer. God, make me a blessing. Amen.
Yeah.